Our next speaker is a really good sport. When we first were talking about doing this conference, we were thinking that we really wanted to get you guys outside and that we would have stations and they would go around, and Erin agreed to that. And then we decided, if we can't get people back from breaks, how are we going to get them from one station to another? So we decided to go to the more standard, but Erin is still with us, so we really appreciate that. She's an outreach educator for the Department of Environmental Conservation for the past 9 years. She develops and distributes outreach materials and gives presentations on lands and forest topics. The majority of her time with the department has revolved around invasive forest pest issues. She received her associate's degree from Finger Lakes Community College and her bachelor's at the SUNY College of Environmental Science and Forestry. So thank you for being here, Erin.
Hello.
So we just need you to put that on.
Put this on.
Then it will be five.
Okay. And then.
So you move the mouse. You can advance with the mouse, or you can advance with the keys on the bottom. And you probably are going to need to bend since you're after Brian. Bend that down so that.
I'm vertically challenged. So. Okay. So.
Brian's vertically challenged.
Anyway, so yes, I'm basically going to cover how to identify some of these forest pests. I'm not really going to go over their history or anything like that, but I am around, so if you have any questions, please let me know. But first I wanted to start with what to do if you find something, because that's always like, you know, we talk about these all the time and we forget to say the next step, which is if you see something, say something. Great, all across the board. But and the one important one I forgot, and I realized when Jen was doing her talk, I'm like, I forgot to put IMAP invasives on there. Very, very important resource for reporting infestations or infections or anything that you find plant, animal, insect-wise. But we have our forest health program with an email address, the Forest Health Information Line, formerly known as the EAB hotline, formerly known as the Firewood hotline. We renamed it to be like all-inclusive. I and my coworker Emma answer that. Your local prisms are fantastic resources. Talk to them. And then the Asian Longhorn Beetle hotline, which goes to the Department of Ag and Markets down in Long Island. We share, so get one of us and we will communicate it around. But it's definitely very important that if you see anything, to make sure to report it, because that's, as mentioned earlier, that's where we get a lot of our information, is from the general public and from citizen science. So the first one, I kind of ranked these according to importance. The first two are pretty important. The other ones have mixed reviews across the board, but I know the last one, I put it last only because I knew Mark was going to be covering hemlock woolly adelgid, not because it's ranked last or anything like that. But Asian longhorn beetle is one where we can still affect change with that. We can eradicate it. And they're doing a great job down in Long Island and in the city. This is how the quarantine stands is now, but they're very close, I heard, to declaring Queens at least are fully eradicated, so that's good. But the Long Island one brings up a good point as far as we have a pool survey that we do for Asian longhorn beetle, and that actually brought to their attention a new part of that infestation. Basically, the north end of that infestation was found because of the pool survey going out. It wasn't found in a pool. I don't think it's ever been found in a pool. But the picture at being out there and the press that it got, someone noticed it and went, oh my goodness, I saw that on my porch the other day, and they took a photo and it turns out it was. So that did help extend that infestation. So the first step in identifying something is knowing what it attacks. Unfortunately, with Asian longhorn beetle, it does attack 20 different genera of trees. So instead of going through all of those, I would say the first thing to do if you're worried about Asian longhorn beetles, actually look at what they leave behind, the signs that they leave behind, and go in the other direction. This is just, these are trees that are in trouble, and with most of our forest pests, the trees are going to look like they're in trouble, so it's always good to take another step closer and really look at what's going on, because the trees are going, if they're losing their branches, it could be drought-related environmental factors, it could be native pests, it can be invasive pests, it can be someone, like your neighbor, putting copper nails into your tree because they want you to take it down or something. Like, there, it's happened. So you got to take a closer look at what's going on, and this is where you get to signs that it might be Asian longhorn beetles. So they spiral, the adults spiral as they come out of the tree, and they leave behind a perfectly round hole about the size of a dime. We have some pieces of wood on our table, as well as I think some of the other groups brought samples as well. Take a look and you'll see it's perfectly round, size of a dime, and as they're coming out, the trees are in full leaf, so there's going to be sap oozing out of those holes. So first you'll see as you can see with the finger right there, the holes, and then down below where the sap starts to ooze after it's been cut through. The egg deposit sites are a good thing to look for, but they're not always present. I've heard this insect described as lazy multiple times, both in how it flies and also apparently how it lays its eggs, because traditionally they would chew a deposit and leave one or two eggs in that deposit, but they were finding down in Long Island that if there wasn't enough of like a crevice or something, they would not chew at all. They just drop it. So it's not always reliable, but on a smooth surface, it can be. So the feeding behavior of the adult is actually diagnostic along the rib there. That's going to be harder to find, but worth looking for. Another good one to look for is the frass, which is the woody excrement of the beetles as they're coming out and going in as well, because the larvae get pretty big. They're pushing this stuff out, and it gathers on the branches and around the base of the tree. So it's certainly noticeable and definitely an indication that you have a large insect attacking the tree. And then, of course, there's the beetle itself. The larva, there are a lot of people that are more knowledgeable than I am that could tell you the differences in the larva and how you can tell one from the other, but it looks like a generic larva to me. I can't tell the difference. I know Jessica Cancellari at our lab can put them under a microscope and count different things like segments and how the beak looks on the front of the head and all that kind of stuff, but to the general public, it's just not something that I think that they'll be able to distinguish. So, but again, if you know you have a maple tree and you have other signs that have indicate that it could be Asian longhorn beetle, you can collect that insect and submit it to our lab for, you know, it to be keyed out to see if it is one of the ones that we're worried about. But it's always good to take samples and pictures whenever possible. And then there's lookalikes. There's lookalikes for a lot of our invasive pests, and this is one of the most commonly mistaken for Asian longhorn beetle. It's the white-spotted pine sawyer. There's a whole slew of other ones because we have a lot of black and white insects, but the white-spotted pine sawyer, I would say, is 92%, very accurate, of the time that people say that they think they've seen Asian longhorn beetle. It's this, and you can see from the arrow that one white spot on the white-spotted pine sawyer is always white on that one and always black on the Asian longhorn beetle. Otherwise, the sawyer can actually be a little bit variable. So sometimes it's all black and there's absolutely no white on it except for that white dot. So I remember going up into the Adirondacks to do a program, and my car is very messy and things fly around, and I went to pull stuff out of my passenger seat, and I saw, I thought my Asian longhorn beetle display had opened up and the bug had fallen out and it was on the ground. So I go to pick up the beetle and it moved, and I went, oh my God, it's in Moffett Beach! And then I looked and I saw that it was a white spot. I'm like, oh yeah. So that was fun for me. Something I recently learned, though, to help with everybody else in understanding when they're flying, is they do have different emergence times. So the white-spotted pine sawyer will come out earlier. It's usually end of May into June, and the Asian longhorn beetle doesn't emerge until like late July into August. So whenever we start getting the calls about Asian longhorn beetle, it starts in May, and that's timed perfectly with when the spotted sawyer is coming out. Okay, so on to oak wilt, another priority, new-ish for New York State. I mean, the Glenville infection site was in 2008, and then again in 2013. They're pretty sure they got that, but last year was a terrible year, or a good year if you're oak wilt. Canandaigua, and several sites on Long Island and one in Brooklyn. All of that coming in was very disappointing. Canandaigua, they have a good handle on, but the worry now is where did it come from, how did it get there kind of thing. So they're doing a lot of surveying to see if there's additional sites that have not been detected over there yet. Brooklyn, same thing, but the biggest worry is Suffolk County because of the number of spots they found and that it's spread across Long Island. So you have one in the middle, you have one in the eastern side, and you have one on the western side. So it's very likely that it's in a lot more locations in Suffolk County than we know, but they're doing a lot of surveying right now to figure that out. It's a tough one because the only way you can really identify it is through testing. We have the signs and the symptoms that help us lead to which ones to test, but they are hard to tell. Truly, just from looking, it's not easy. Of course, there's an extra wonderful aspect of the fact that the white group, which is white oaks, scrub oaks, swamp white oaks, and bur oaks, along with a whole host of others, the ones with the rounded lobes, have a very low rate of both how it presents and sometimes how quickly it can die. It can take up to like 7 years, I think, for a white oak group tree to die. So the signs are really hard to spot. With the red group, that's scarlet oak, pin oak, regular red oak, black oak. They're much more susceptible. So they will die usually in the same season that they're infected. And so some of the things to look for right now, I mean, we just, white oak, we're certainly worried if it's starting to show signs, but we're trying to concentrate on the red oak since they're much more clear on the symptoms, as well as the fact that they're a bigger carrier, or there's a more chance of a spread through the red oak group. So they have rapid leaf drop, and they call it the July 4th disease because it usually happens right around July to August when you'll see a large number of the leaves drop. They will drop so quickly that they'll still have a lot of green left on them. So the loss with the red group tends to come from the crown downward, but I always say they don't read the same books we do, so if you see leaves that are turning brown in the middle of summer and they're falling off, that's cause for alarm. You should probably check it out. The other thing that'll happen, which is something that's not exactly what we want to look for because it's a year later, the spore pads or fungal mats will form after the tree dies the following year. Hopefully we found it by then and the tree's gone. But it's another thing that could be looked for. And just so you know, death will occur 2 to 6 weeks. It's very, very quick. With the white oak group, sometimes it's only one or two branches that show the sign. The fungal mats seldom occur, which means that's one of the reasons why it's kind of a dead end for the disease. If there's no fungal mat, then there's no fungal spores for insects to carry on, which is one of the ways it travels. The other one is it can travel through the roots. And white oaks don't tend to root graft. So hopefully, being the fact that it's not a very good indication, you know, when you're looking at a white oak, whether it has oak wilt or not, it's a good thing that it's also not a large concern for the spread of the disease. The brown coloring of the leaves, it does have a diagnostic feature, and that's the fact that it's a solid line usually between the brown portion and the green portion. There are other things that can happen to oak leaves where you'll see it turning brown along the veins and in spots throughout the leaf, but when it comes to the oak wilt, it's pretty much a solid wall of brown against the green. And it can come as a half the leaf is brown, half the leaf is green. It could be from the outside in and have the center area be green, but all the green's going to be connected and all the brown's going to be connected. I did want to point out the bottom picture I put in there because we had a lot of people calling because they were losing their oak leaves during the summer, but the oak leaves were fully green, but they were in clusters, and that is a sign of a couple different kinds of insects, including cicadas and root or twig girdlers. That's just something that they do. It's native, not a problem. So it's really the coloration that you gotta look for, not necessarily a group of leaves falling off on a twig. That's usually a sign of something else. And then, of course, here's a couple things. You have a tree. When all the other trees are nice and green, that tree was green in the beginning of the year, and now it's pretty much dead. That's a bad sign. And then, of course, leaves on the ground when you're supposed to be mulching and mowing and fertilizing because it's full growing season and not fall. And then the staining can occur, but that's a hard one to see since it's under the bark. Okay, so emerald ash borer. This is where it gets a little bit easier for identification because they only attack one tree. I have a slide next that I'll show you how to identify ash trees in case you don't know, but emerald ash borer, this is a current map that we have. It's getting out there. There's a lot of people, depending on who you talk to, it's widespread, it's already there, why are we bothering? There's still some use to figuring out exactly where it is and notifying people, because as you can see, there's large pink areas in between all those green dots. And those people are in the current quarantine, but they don't have a confirmed infestation yet. And it is really important that we know where these are and let people know, because we're definitely getting an influx of questions and concerns about they have ash trees that are dying. As Jerry mentioned earlier, we talk about it, and they don't listen until they actually see. So now they're being reactive rather than proactive. We do have some good examples of proactiveness in the states. The city of Syracuse and the city of Rochester were fantastic in going out and surveying and doing all that stuff first. We're hoping there will be additional towns and places that will take advantage of that. So we're going to keep doing our survey efforts to try and give them an early warning system so they can decide what they want to do with their ash before they have to deal with their ash. Ash trees, I think, in my opinion, are one of the easier ones to identify. They have opposite branching, opposite directly across from each other, alternate, which are most of our trees, have alternating leaves like this. And the way I remember which ones have opposite branches and leaves are mad horsemen. So you have maple's ashes and dogwoods, and then you have horse chestnuts. So that's something I learned in college, passing it on. So it has a compound leaf. That whole thing is one leaf, and it has leaflets. So if the leaves are on and it has opposite branching, there's really only one tree you can confuse it with, and that's the box elder, which is a type of maple. The bark has distinctive ridges. They kind of look like A's or diamonds, depending on how you view it. I always think A for ash or diamond. Baseball bats are made out of ash, so take your pick. It can be difficult, even with all those, with the leaves on, the opposite branching, and the diamond-shaped bark, to distinguish it from the box elder, because it can look very similar. So you have to, the box elder will have, instead of an entire leaf like that, the box elders will have an occasional lobe that comes out that looks like a traditional maple leaf. So you want to take in multiple leaves to make sure that you're getting a good view of what the general norm is for the tree. And then the other thing is, if it's a nice tall straight tree in the woods, chances are it's going to be an ash, because most of the box elders are like kind of trashy trees, and they grow all over the place, and they look like ash trees are when, you know, they're really, really stressed and not supposed to be in a location. And then they can also have purple branching, especially towards the base, coming out of the sides of the tree. So they are difficult, but there's lots of helpful resources online too, in case you get confused. So with emerald ash borer, as with Asian longhorn beetle, you have to look close to the tree, because the first signs are going to be the tree is in distress. So it's going to be losing branches. It's going to be you know, having the epicormic branching coming out and, you know, losing limbs left and right. So it's, you have to take a closer look, because there's not a lot of things that specifically say that it's emerald ash borer, because we have a lot of native things, unfortunately, that are affecting ash, including, well, not natives. Ash yellows is not native. Ash yellows has been affecting ash for years, and that's actually what they thought was going on in the Hudson Valley until someone took a closer look. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it was emerald ash borer. So you have to use multiple symptoms. So there's the crown dieback. I've seen trees that were fully infested with emerald ash borer that had no dead branches, but the leaves were really tiny, so you could see through the crown. So it can present in different ways. And there's the epicormic branching and the bark splits. Anyone who's coming tomorrow to the IMAP Invasives, I can show you a perfect bark split at Five Rivers, where you can actually see the larval galleries in it, which is really neat. So the what happens is, as the larvae are tunneling back and forth, they're killing the area underneath the bark and about the size of your hand. And if it's a young infestation, the tree's still vigorous, it's going to grow the next year, and that area of dead bark is going to split and pull apart. And sometimes it can be large enough of a split that you can see the larval galleries underneath. But one of our best ones is woodpeckers. In fact, I just read a paper the other day that said that there is not just a marked increase in woodpeckers, which we've been hearing for a while because of the number of larvae out there, but that they're so large, in fact, that they think they're actually helping with control now. Before, it was just, you know, lots of woodpeckers, you know, they're general predators, so if they get them, they get them. But now, I guess they have shown in a few areas in Michigan that they're actually helping turn the tide just a little bit. Not enough, but a little bit. But the feeding behavior for woodpeckers on ash that are going after emerald ash borer larvae is very specific. Like, our natives tend to go after, or our native larvae are actually going at in straight lines of the tree because they're following rod, or there's this very specific area that they're attacking on the tree, whereas emerald ash borer can attack the tree anywhere, so that means the woodpecker can find them anywhere. And since they're just under the bark, the woodpecker does not have to do those traditional large holes that you might see that a pileated woodpecker would do going after carpenter ants in the middle. They just have to flake off the outer edge of the bark in order to grab them. And the holes in which they make to pull up the larvae are also very small and hard to see. So it's just a general blonding of the wood. So have been trees, especially in the lower Hudson Valley, that I've seen that are completely brown looking, like light brown, because all the bark has been removed because it was so riddled with emerald ash borer. But it'll start off a little bit patchy, and then it'll get really intense, as you can see on those pictures. And then the proof positive would be the only two signs the emerald ash borer leaves behind for us to see are the D-shaped exit hole, which is incredibly tiny. We have a piece of wood at our table if you want to take a look. When you're looking at an 80-foot tree, it's not easy to see. And we actually outline them in pink so that you can really get a good look. The larval galleries, you know, emerald ash borer, if you're looking at an ash tree and you have larval galleries and they go in a serpentine back and forth, it's definitely emerald ash borer. None of our natives do that. But as you can see from that one, it's so heavily infested that those galleries are running into each other, so sometimes it can be hard to distinguish one gallery from the other. But that's a very diagnostic. Unfortunately, you have to peel the bark in order to figure that out. So if the tree is still living, you're hurting it too. Okay, so I'm going to go over southern pine beetle really quick. I was thinking of taking this out just to save on time, but I was like, yeah, it's kind of important. I was talking to Linda earlier, and Lower Hudson is helping to survey the areas down there around Bear Spring Mountain and stuff, where we have found them in traps to make sure that we're not going to have a problem further north than we are in Suffolk County. But it's a very tiny insect, and it also infests lots of trees. They have a preference of the pitch pine right now on Long Island, but they'll go to anything, especially when they're in outbreak portions like they are now. So you can find them on hemlock and in spruce and white pine. There's definitely a suggestion that they don't do as well on those trees, that they don't reproduce, but they still can attack it and kill it. So it's a concern. So these trees will die 2 to 3 months, definitely. And they go, they turn this red color because they're dying so quickly. It's the beetles working in concert, attacking the tree in thousands together. They have these pheromones that they send out, call everybody into a group, and they go after the tree. As they do that, the pines can actually defend themselves. So if there weren't so many, they could withstand the attack. And one of the things they do is they pitch them out. So anytime they sense the attack, they send extra sap, pushes out and creates these like popcorn ball size little pitch tubes. We do have a native that looks very much like the southern pine beetle, but there's a difference in size. So whereas the southern pine beetle is like the size of a chocolate sprinkle, the other one, which is the black turpentine beetle, is more of the size of a grain of rice. So you make the distinction. But the pitch tubes, for the southern pine beetle, it's gonna be about the size of a dime, and for the turpentine, it's gonna be the size of a quarter. So it's certainly a little bit bigger. And I've heard the galleries described as S-shaped galleries, but we use that for emerald ash borer, and I look at that and I don't see an S. I see a lot of different curves, so they're really, really curvy, but I don't see an S. But so it's just under the bark, you'll see all those little tiny galleries, and the most important one is definitely the pitch tubes. And then as far as another difference between the black turpentine and the southern pine beetle is where on the tree they're located. So black turpentine tends to attack the tree in the lower 10 feet, so just down near the base and a little bit above your head. But if you see pitch tubes all the way up to the top of the tree, that's a sign of southern pine beetle. That's the turpentine beetle will not go that far up. Okay, and so the last one I'll do a quick, because I know Mark already covered a little bit, but just to point out I forgot I did this. You gotta identify in hemlock. There's another one where it's a host specific. So hemlocks are evergreens, but unlike pines, it's one needle out at a time, not multiple needles. They're flat sprays. The cones are pendulum, which means they hang. And then the underneath the, if you turn the branch over, you can see the two white lines on the needles. So those are relatively easy to identify. Sometimes people can confuse hemlock with firs, but firs tend to have not flat sprays, but slight ray on the top. So these are literally just needles coming out on two sides, flat sprays, and one at a time to distinguish them from pines. The bark, I think you can get to know the bark after time, but I don't know of a way to describe it, really. I can tell you that if you go to Mangat Pond, it's the ones that are heavily covered in sapsucker holes. For some reason, they like them there. That it's one of those things where you have to kind of get to know it over time to really be able to pull them out. Oh, went too far. Okay, so as far as detection, when you're walking along and you know you're near hemlocks, just pick up the branches and turn them upside down, because that's where you'll see those waxy woolly substances, the sacs that they make to protect their eggs. They can be visible year-round, although they only make them once a year, so during the winter is actually the best time to survey. But they're sticky, so they'll stick around for a while. Some of the things that we use are tennis balls covered in Velcro. So I think actually Parks, Bob O'Brien came up with that, I believe. And so they'll throw those up into the canopy, and then when they come to... Oh no! Sorry. Did you come up?
They're squash balls.
Squash balls?
Yeah.
Oh, all right, squash balls. I wasn't sure what you. I wasn't sure what you were referring to. I was like, was that your idea, not Bob's? Okay, squash balls. Anyway, so I'll have to change that. Something that, because those sacks are sticky, if the ball goes up and attaches it, you know, comes down, you'll know that it's up in the canopy. Otherwise, it can be difficult to find if you're just surveying the base, but it's worth it. If you're walking along, taking a hike, you know, it's worth taking a look. The other thing that was pointed out to me, which I've never actually encountered, is because I've never seen a tree that's actually been fully killed by hemlock woolly adelgid. Lucky me. Gray tinted foliage. So, like, you have trees that die, the needles will turn brown, but apparently with hemlock woolly adelgid damage, it has a gray hue to it. I don't know why that is. Do you know why that is?
Solely the vestiges of the white woolly stuff on the twigs gives a hue.
Oh, okay.
And the other thing that's really important to pay attention to is in the springtime, when the fresh buds are coming out, they're that lime green, you know, like 1965 Volkswagens. If it's infested with hemlock woolly adelgid, it won't be putting out those shoots, so you can see it a mile away.
Okay, so and then those woolly substances I didn't mention are basically, imagine the tip of a Q-tip, like the very top part of it. That's about the size that you're going to be looking for. And we have a lot of lookalikes, things that are often confused. We have the spittle bugs. There are a lot of people that, you know, they'll see it, they don't realize that it's just the it's moisture. It's not actually a woolly substance. Spider egg sacs. We've had people turn that into the lab before. Pine sap, as it, you know, drips and dries, it can look a little white like the woolly sacs, and the spider mites as well. And then we also have, I don't know if I have it on here. Yeah, I do. The hemlock or the elongate hemlock scale. Which is similar, but I believe that the main difference is the fact that that's on the needle and the hemlock woolly adelgid are at the base of the needles. But otherwise, they can, to the untrained eye, they can look similar. I know they look similar to me, so but no woolly substances for those. And then I wanted to throw this in, and someone I talked to today helped remind me to do so. We get a lot of calls about, in general, for forest pests, something's making lines of holes on my tree, and they always think it's an insect, and this is actually the yellow-bellied sapsucker. And it's important to know the difference between them, because although sapsuckers can kill trees, as you can see the one that with the actual picture of the bird, that looks like a birch. I've seen them kill ornamental birch before because they hammer them so hard they can actually girdle the tree. But over here is a more classic look for some trees that, you know, maybe hit once in a while. And all they're doing is they're drilling the small holes to attract insects as the sap runs, and then they come back and eat them. I usually say that I don't know of many insects that are that coordinated to come out in a line. So. So that's it. I just wanted to put a reminder of the Forest Health Information Line. Please give us a call if you see anything. Pictures are important, and whenever you take pictures, put something in for scale, because we have no idea how big that hole is or whatever you're taking a picture of. So that's it.
Thank you.